how do I recommend reasoning with a conspiracy theorist?
Well, first of all, I think there's a gene. I think there's a gene for superstition, a gene for hearsay, a gene for magic, a gene for magical thinking. And I think that when we were in the forest, that gene actually helped us. Because 9 times out of 10, that gene was wrong. Superstition didn't work. But 1 time out of 10, it saved your butt. That's why the gene is still here. The gene for superstition and magic. Now, there's no gene for science. Science is based on things that are reproducible, testable. It's a long process, the scientific method. It's not part of our natural thinking.
I'm right now, the last couple months, I've been messing around with this idea of cognitive dissonance. This is to say, you have a worldview. You're presented with evidence that conflicts with the worldview, so you either have to change your worldview, which is hard because you've lived your whole life with it, or you just dismiss the evidence and dismiss the authorities that may have provided the evidence. The authority could be a person, or it could be a book, or, excuse me, an article on the electric internet computer machine. So you dismiss the evidence so that you don't have this discomfort, this conflict in your mind, this dissonance.
But we can also see it in conspiracy thinking, where these fringe groups, or at least they used to be fringe groups, on kind of the outskirts of thinking about what could be real or what is happening, paranoid thinking, for instance, thinking about reptoids controlling our government. There have always been people who believed these sort of strange things, but what social media and the internet in general has allowed to happen is for people with these beliefs to find each other. And then when they're hearing back those same sorts of facts, those same sorts of theories, then their beliefs strengthen.
What the skeptical movement has developed is a set of tools, like the baloney detection kit, a set of tools to deal with particular claims that are on the margins of science, like creationism, intelligent design theory, you know, the anti-vaccinations, the Holocaust revisionists, you know, all these conspiracy theories and so on, all these alternative medicines. And, you know, there's a whole hundreds and hundreds of these claims that are all connected to different sciences. But the scientists in those particular fields are too busy working in their research to bother with what these claims are, because the claims really aren't about those fields. They're just hooked to them. They're about something else.
I think that fear is an incredibly dangerous emotion. I think that it causes us to narrow our thinking. I think it causes us to shut down options. And there are a lot of threats in the world, but I think what we need to face those threats are open, creative, playful thinking. And when we think as a hive mind, when we think collectively and we do so in a fearful sense, then that shuts down a lot of our thinking.
It's a struggle. It's a struggle that's eternal, because I think it's part of our genetic makeup, okay? And there's even a name for some of this superstition. It's called pareidolia. What is pareidolia? It's the idea that when you look in the sky, you see things that are not there. Let's do an experiment. Look at the clouds and try not to see something there. It's very difficult. You look at the clouds, you can't help it. You see Donald Duck, you see Mickey Mouse, you see snakes, animals, you see all sorts of stuff. You can't help it. Recently, the Notre Dame Cathedral partially burned down. And sure enough, somebody said, I see Jesus Christ there. I saw the picture, maybe you did too. It really did look like Jesus Christ, but it was the ashes of Notre Dame. And how many times do people see the Virgin Mary in a glass of tea? So we are hardwired to see things that are not there, because for the most part, they're harmless. For the most part, they do nothing. And once in a while, it saves our butt. And so that's why I think we will have flat earthers. We will have the people who don't like vaccination, because hearsay throughout human history was the dominant form of information sharing.
One thing that I think we tend to do is we think that we're going to be the person who is going to crack a big mystery, who's going to solve a whole puzzle. I think that Hollywood has given us this idea. And the famous book and movie, The Da Vinci Code, sold us on this, right? That we were going to be the hero who would figure everything out, this big, vast conspiracy. And I think the romanticization of that is dangerous. And I think that we all think that we're going to be this hero who's going to discover some secret thing.
People find comfort in sort of attenuating the anxiety or uncertainty they're feeling by concocting some overarching plan. This is what's going on. Now I understand it. Now I don't have to feel so uncertain about the environment. So people concoct conspiracy theories for that main reason.
Think about it. You know, are you only believing conspiracy theories because you want them to be true? That's when you know there's trouble.
Apparently the way to overcome that is to say, we're all in this together. Let's learn about this together. Present the conspiracy theorist with the idea that he or she may be rejecting evidence because it's just so uncomfortable. And you're in it together. We're in it together. I'm uncomfortable too. But when it comes to moon landings, just ask the person how you would generate all that paperwork. The warehouse is full of documentation that NASA created to make landings on the moon would overwhelm anybody trying to do it on the side. It'd just be very difficult to print all that. And just understand it's a process. Somebody who has a worldview that's inconsistent with evidence, and I may have some, it takes a while for you to turn around. Like the example of palm reading or astrology, it's not something people reverse their ideas about immediately. It takes, in my experience, it takes about 2 years for somebody to sort of look at palm reading, look at cold reading or a tarot card reading for a while, and then realize that these tarot card readers, palm readers, are just taking information that you've given them, the client's given them, and feeding it back to you.
The further out you go in the extreme nature of a conspiracy theory, the less likely the theory is to be true. The more people that have to be involved in the conspiracy theory, the less likely it is to be true. The more elements that have to come together just at the right moment to make the conspiracy work, the less likely it is to be true. And the more global it is, you know, world domination, that sort of thing, the less likely it is to be true. Conspiracies usually are very narrowly focused, you know, like insider trading or corporate manipulation, like Volkswagen with the emissions, or, you know, some government attempting to manipulate an election. It's a very specific thing that the conspiracy is really about.
The way we get the information, 24-hour bombardment, makes people feel afraid. And you've got a lot of people who feel like dangerous shut-ins, you know, who are railing against how sad things are or dropping out because they're overwhelmed. And because of that dropout and that polarization, you get a regime like Trump. You get a fertile ground for fascism, which is about blaming someone irrationally for other problems in your life. It's an old game that has been played for millennia. That immigrant, that transgender person, that person who is of a different race, their very existence threatens you because they're getting attention, money, they're stealing something from you. And that certainly found its way into a World War II, but also the fragile state of truth right now, which also comes out of digital addiction, is that all conspiracy theories are true, all news is suspect, facts are fungible. And in a world like that, that's the biggest danger.
The problem is this: none of us has the truth. The only way to find out that if you're deceiving yourself or not, if you've gone off the rails, if you're wrong in some way, is to listen to other people who disagree with you. And these were the original arguments laid down by John Stuart Mill, 1859, on liberty. This is the classic work. One, I might be partially wrong. And so by listening to somebody who disagrees with me, I get to correct my idea. Two, I might be completely wrong and off the rails, and boy, good thing I figured this out before I went too far. Three, I might be completely right, but I'm not 100% sure about my arguments, and hearing somebody on the other side helps me refine my arguments and strengthen my arguments. If I can refute that conservative or that radical leftist or whoever it is then how much stronger my position is. And four, it's not just the speaker's right to speak, it's the listener's right to listen. Maybe I, the protester, don't want to hear this person, but maybe there's people in the room that do want to hear this person for whatever reason. It's none of my business. So, and then finally, in terms of moral progress that I like to track, one of the biggest drivers for the last five centuries has been the principle of free speech. This is at the basis of all liberal democracies, of all civil societies, that everybody must have the freedom to express their points of view, no matter how much we dislike them. I don't care if you're a Nazi or you think we didn't land on the moon or whatever your ideas are. Go ahead and tell us your best arguments, and we'll see in the marketplace of ideas how well you do.
You know, the internet is very new. Newspapers are very new. Science and technology is very new. But gossip, hearsay, slander, rumors, there's a gene for that, okay? So how do you combat it? Slowly, carefully, painfully. It's a painful process, but in some sense, we're going up against our genetic predisposition to believe in nonsense.
In some ways, we're in a better world than we've ever been in terms of like health and you know, human rights at least being considered in different countries, and partly that's because of digital stuff. You know, you can't actually shut down digital communication no matter how hard you try in China or wherever. There's VPNs, people get through. So there are advantages to that.
I think that we need to weigh in, let experts weigh in. I think that we need to trust expertise. And I think that we need to look at Snopes.com rather than YouTube for our information. I think that we need to regain our trust in scientists and in people who have spent their life's work studying a phenomena rather than thinking we're going to hunt down the answer on the internet.
This whole idea of what we now call fake news, alternative facts, has gotten bigger and bigger. And it just gets unfolded in real time online within minutes and hours, and we have to jump on it fast. But also developing a set of tools that can apply to any future ideas. Because I don't know what's going to be popular in 5 years from now. Heck, I don't know what's going to be trending tomorrow.
People have just lost sight of history, and we all tend to go, well, look at the facts. Change your mind. But it takes people a couple years.
Consider your conspiracy theories. You have a problem with them if you only believe the ones you want to.
Get smarter faster with new videos every week from the world's biggest thinkers.